So, thanks a lot. My name is Sebastian Graf. As you can probably see on the introductory slide, I'm working with Santaro here in Germany within different roles over the last few years, but all of these roles were somehow related to stuff that is forwarding a packet. And this is also what I'm going to talk about today. So before we actually start, some disclaimers about this talk. As it was already introduced, this talk doesn't work on its own because it's heavily relying on some other talks that you have seen before. So on the one hand, I'm not really covering the basics about segment routing because there was already a presentation done by me on DNOC 8 where I did talk about traffic engineering with segment routing, and this talk is heavily relying on this, obviously. It's also somehow related to the talk from my colleague, Tobias Heister from DNOC 10, where he talked about using open source tools to do traffic engineering in MPLS networks. And obviously, it's heavily relying on Leonir's talks that you just saw a minute ago, where he talked about the basics concept. And so I'm actually happy to assume that you all understand it, because there were no questions. So we can right ahead start at and look at about two topics in more detail. So another thing to mention in order to avoid confusion, you typically see two terms around when you talk about segment routing. One is Spring, and the other one is segment routing. And actually, you can more or less use these two terms interchangeably. So Spring is actually an abbreviation for source packet routing in networking. So you have to put some attention to the G at the end of networking. This is actually the name of the working group within the IETF that is working on all the standards that are related in there, whereas segment routing is commonly used as a term to describe the actual concept that we use for forwarding packets and to push the state of the forwarding into the packet itself and not into the network anymore. Now, it would be nicer if these terms would be used a bit more, you know, in the same way. But even if you take a look at the working drafts documents, you see that also there, sometimes it is called segment routing, sometimes it is called Spring, but it's more or less using the same stuff. So if you take a look at the working group directory of the IETF working group for Spring, you see there's a lot of movement in there. So there are actually five RFCs available. There are 10 active internet drafts and closely to 100 related drafts that are working done by other working groups, but still somehow related to Spring or segment routing. And we are going to take a closer look at two of these. So Leonir already gave some brief introduction of FlexAlgo. We are going to look a little more detailed about this use case with the delay-based forwarding and how this is then actually signaled in the network. And at the next point, we are looking at what I like to call the war of data plane encapsulations, because MPLS is not the only thing around there. There are some alternatives, some of them already very mature and very close to getting a final RFC, whereas with other ones, which are more into the discussion and in the political debate right now. So I'm actually going to skip this slide because this is explaining how MPLS goes around with the pushing and popping of labels. This was already covered by Leonir. Just one thing to keep in mind with an MPLS, we are usually just considering the top label when we are on a transit node. And from time to time, we might push a label, we might swap a label, and we might actually pop a label if we don't need it anymore at this point in time. So what is happening by default, we always have an underlying IGP that is doing shortest path calculation according to the Dijkstra algorithm. Actually, for those of you who have not looked into that detail at this algorithm, it's ridiculously simple. It's really just a handful of rules which are executed recursively in order to build a directed path from the perspective of the local node in order to find a loop-free topology. And this is what you can see here on the slides. We have two examples, one of them being from the perspective of R1 and the other one being from the perspective of R3. So obviously you need some kind of metric that you use to identify which path is a good path, which path is a bad path. Usually this is somehow imposed with either statically set metric on the links or use a concept of a reference bandwidth. So taking a look at this very, very simple example, we're having three links of 100G and one link of 10G. And if you would, for example, use the reference bandwidth of 100G, you would have three links down here, which would actually have a metric of 1. So you would have this path here, and you would have a metric of 10 on this path in here. So obviously, in this very simple example, it's no big surprise what R1 and R3 would actually do. So you see that both of them are actually building a directed graph with itself on the root of the tree. And you see that R1 would forward a packet to R3 on the direct link and would forward a packet towards R4 on the link towards R2. While R3, at the same point in time, if it would need to forward a packet to R4, it would actually skip the link down below because it would be a metric of 10 and the link on the top would have a metric of 3, which is better, so it would use this pass. And this is already the problem that you usually get with default IGP metrics. You have little stuff that you can actually do, and you have a very fixed amount of, or very fixed situation about how the traffic is actually going. So typically, you have a lot of possibilities to change this. So we saw yesterday some possibilities how to actually change it if you are in control of the host that actually constructs a packet and can already soon indicate some desires about how it should be forwarded in the network by actually generating the labels already. If you don't have control over the service, you have to rely with what the network is actually offering you. And usually what has done and what we did in the past, especially if there was no MPLS, is you try to tune the IGP metrics, which from a precision point of view is something like a hammer. Yeah? So you change it in one end, but the problem is you actually affect all of your flows and you have to be very careful about how to change the metrics in there. And usually you never get up at the totally perfect result, so it doesn't really work to be precise. Otherwise, you can use signaling protocols like RSVP if you run an MPLS network where you can actually signal paths that are different from the network, what the IGP would do of itself. You can also now with segment routing, as it was pointed out, you can also use this as an alternative, like having a static segment routing configuration on R3, for example, to push the traffic towards R4 and not use the IGP pass, which is more or less the same concept, but it's not signaled, but it would be on the ingress node. So this is then already much more precise, so more like a scalpel that you can use to precisely specify what you want to do. But obviously, it's not a good idea to do this on a high scale with manual configuration on these boxes. And so, as we saw in the talk earlier, you also have the possibilities to use a controller that externally injects certain paths in your network and controls that remotely. So this is then the remotely controlled scalpel, but it's still adding another layer of complexity. And you have to be sure that this is also working when the controller fails, because your network should somehow still do anything when the controller fails. And usually what the network does in the best case then is falling back to the default IGP, which is then maybe a good idea or maybe not. So now with Flex Algo, as it was briefly pointed out by Leonie, we have the possibility now to use different kind sets of metrics on the links. Actually, there are two areas for Flex Algo from the ID values. So you have the IDs from 0 to 127, which are the well-known ones, which are assigned by IANA for the identification. And you have the ones on top of 128, which can be used by the operator as needed. But obviously, if you don't build your own routing daemon or your own networking gear, you have to rely on what your vendor is offering. So this is just one example about what you could do if latency is, for example, an important point. You get the point that you can actually use the link between R3 and R4 for latency critical traffic. And this is really being done by advertising multiple metrics within the LSDB. And at the end, R3, so in this case we have both examples from R3, would build the SPF for both of these topology or both of these algorithms or algos, and you would see that it will come to a different result. Now obviously this has not solved yet the task to decide which traffic should be affected by this. So we still need to do some mapping on R3 where, for example, decide I have some fat flows and this should be mapped to the longer path that has the higher capacity, and I have some latency critical traffic that I can actually push on the direct way. And this is something that that Flex Algo doesn't solve for you. This is still something that the vendor itself needs to do and needs to find solutions for, or the operator who is actually operating this gear. But as you can see, you have the possibility to define different kind of traffic flows. So we have the blue topology and the red topology. So it's kind of very similar to multi-topology ISIS that we probably know from the past, but it's now using a similar concept taken to the new world of segment routing. And actually, the mechanisms that are used for this are already in the standard for quite some time. So what you see down below here, this is actually an output from a Juniper MX device, and it's actually some output that I personally steal from my old presentation from DNAC 8. I just highlighted some other parts, but you can see here already that even in a very early implementation, it was already signaling these capabilities. So in this case, we can see that the router is advertising that it supports the algo 0, which is SPF, and it's advertising which algorithm it supports in total. So what we end up with at the end, that we are using two different algorithms, and you see here in the topology, it's simply solved by using different SIDs per different algorithm. So it's really like you can actually forward the traffic on the different planes. So whenever R3 forwards a packet to R1, R1 can identify the topology that this packet is sitting on just by identifying the label. So whether you don't need to worry about VLAN IDs in order to separate topologies or stuff like that. You can just say, hey, this is the same link, and I'm actually using the packet to identify to which algorithm this packet is matching. As we have also seen in the slide from Leonie, you can also specify that some routers are not even part of the topology, which can have lots of interesting use cases. For example, a good old famous Deutschland routing, which is very famous in politics these days. Or you can even specify stuff like, I want to keep the traffic in a certain area, I want it to only cross MACsec enabled links or whatever. And you can simply do this by just specifying the SID or matching the packet to a certain topology. The good thing about this is, obviously, it's kind of similar what a centralized controller gives you, but a little bit, you know, less, has a little bit less complexity, and it's working in a distributed fashion. It has automatic convergence in case of link breaks, obviously only if there is an alternative way in your topology, but all the stuff that Leonie talked about earlier, like TI, LFA, is just working out of the box because we are just using the same mechanics as we have used before. So, actually, the fact that we are not relying on a central intelligence, whether this is a good thing or not, is something that is to be decided by the operator, because there are always some use cases that always work better with a central intelligence, because you have a complete view of the overall network, whereas the local router only sees its local view and might come to not so optimal decisions. Actually, this is currently available as a draft in version 4, but there is already vendor code available. It's not yet from all vendors released as public, as far as I know. However, earlier this year on the MPLS World Congress, there was a demonstration of an interop for segment routing with Flex Algo that used ISIS as the IGP. And as you can see, it was being tested between Juniper MXs and Cisco NCS and ASR9K, and it worked quite nice. So even for so it's probably something that is very closely in getting a final RFC, and then you will already be able to use this kind of functionality. So as I mentioned, whether this is a good thing or not, it depends on your use cases, that it is not on a central intelligence, but as with all technology, you should just consider it as part of your toolbox that you can pull out and push it to a problem that might be solved by this actual. The other thing that I would like to talk about is what I mentioned before, the war of data plane encapsulations. So what we have seen so far is good old MPLS forwarding, like we know it from RFC 3032. Actually, from the perspective for segment routing, nothing really has changed. It's still the old mechanism that has been designed in 2001. So we have at the top, at the very beginning of our MPLS header, we have 32 bits in total. We have 20 bits of the actual MPLS label. Then we have 3 bits that originally be called experimental bits, but were later on in 2009 renamed to traffic class because it has been used to indicate quality of service behavior. We have a stock of bottom bit, which tells you if this is the last label or if there are some other labels coming up. And we have the TTL in order for loop prevention. And this is really how also the first implementations are already running. So there are some networks out there that already use segment routing with MPLS as the data plane, because it was kind of the natural evolution. Because as pointed out, we don't have to have any changes on the data plane because the operations stay the same. We have to push labels. We have to pop labels, we have to swap labels. The only thing that really changed was that we now have the concept of a global SID that doesn't change if you have the global sRGB block on all of your nodes. Then you have a label that is actually not changed, and this is not really part of the original definition of the MPLS data plane. However, most vendors just implemented in a way that they used the swap function and actually swap the value to the same value as before. So this was really no change being done on the ASIC level. And this is always a very important thing if you're introducing new technologies. Whenever you need changes on the data plane, on the ASICs, then the cycle until you actually get this feature is much, much longer. So if you have like a fixed pipeline chipsets in your networking gear, you are basically screwed up if you want to use something that is different from what was there before. If you are having much more intelligent chipsets, which are programmable, which are sold by many vendors, then you actually need to wait until your vendor implements this kind of stuff on the forwarding ASIC for you, and then you can start with this. Or obviously, if you're more into the P4-like minded of people, you can obviously just program the header yourself if you're up to. So this is what was in there for MPLS, but from the day one, Spring was actually also considering IP version 6 as the data plane. And this is what I'm going to talk about a little more detail about now, because there are some fundamental differences with the forwarding compared to MPLS. So what you see in here is the so-called segment routing header, which is consisting of the routing header on the top, which is defined in RFC 8200. Obviously, on top of that, you have to imagine an IP version 6 packet, because this is the outer packet that used to forward this kind of stuff as it's using IP version 6. Didn't include it for making these a bit more easy to read. The good thing about SRv6, as it is called, so whenever you talk about I'm doing not MPLS forwarding with segment routing, but IP version 6, then you usually call this SRv6. And the good thing is you actually now have some functionality that you don't have with MPLS. For example, you can have a discontinuous domain of segment routing enabled devices. So within your path, you can have some routers which are just capable of running IP version 6, but not MPLS or not anything else. And SRv6 actually allows you to still push a packet over this network, whereas MPLS would obviously be dropped if the node in between wouldn't be able to support this. The other thing, which is a very fundamental difference, is that for the first view, you see it looks the same. We have, as we can see in here, in the packet, we have different segment identifiers, which are now 128 bits, so much larger than for the MPLS world. But the fundamental difference is that these SIDs are not popped while the traffic or the packet travels the whole network. So as we have seen with MPLS, then if you stack a certain number of labels on top because you want to steer the traffic, you steer the packet around the network. This is actually also possible, obviously, with SRv6, but the SIDs are actually not popped. They are staying within the packet. So it's a bit of a different concept. So when it reaches the final node can still see all of the labels that were in place there before. So obviously, this gives us a new challenge, because if we still have the whole list of segments, we need to have an identifier to know which is the currently active segment. And this is being done by the segment's left field from the routing header. So this is really a pointer what the currently active segment is in here. So you can actually identify what you need to do. We will talk about this a bit more in detail, because I have some kind of a packet walk, how a packet travels through the network. And then we can see how all these fields interact. So, as I mentioned, the top one is standard RFC 8200. We have the next header fields, which identifies the payload of the original packet or another fancy IP version 6 extension header that might follow the routing header. Then we have the total length of the complete header. We have the routing type, which is 4 for SRv6. Segments left, I've just talked about this. We have the last entry, which gives you the information about what the at which bit position we have the last segment, which is important because you see down below here, we have some optional TLV stuff, which might be there or might be not. And so we can actually use the last entry and the header length field to calculate if there is any TLV stuff down below there. Then we have some flags, which are currently 8 bits of reserved for future use, so they don't have really any sense in there now. And we have a tag field that we can use to actually tag packets in order to give them a certain treatment if they belong, for example, to a certain flow. Like, for example, you have certain IP connectivity within within your segment routing path, and you want to be sure that a certain communication is always being hashed to the same ACMP path, or to if you have a link aggregation group, you want to be sure that it always takes the same link in order to prevent performance penalties. This is an example of what you can use in for to actually signal this to the downstream node. So taking a look how this is actually then looking on the wire, we have a simple example about with 7 routers. 6 of them are actually SRv6 enabled. R2 is a non-SRv6 enabled router. And basically, R1 now wants to send a packet towards R3 and wants to use R3. So R1 wants to send a packet to R6. and wants to use R3 and also R5 as transit nodes. So it wants to use the longer paths for whatever reasons. So now we have at the top the IP version 6 header, which is like we know it. We have source and destination address and the next header field, which is indicating the routing header. So just one point about the IP version 6 SIDs and addresses that you see in here. You see they are quite shortened, so you're probably not that valid if you use them in real life, but actually make it a bit more easy to read. So in reality, you would see real IP version 6 addresses that are valid and that have probably or hopefully been assigned to you. So we see that R1 is actually constructing the IPv6 header and is using itself as the source address and R3 as the destination address. And this is kind of interesting because R3 is the first segment routing enabled router on the path. And in this case, it has been either been done because we don't care how the packet gets to R3, or we have some non-segment routing enabled devices like R2 that cannot run anything else than just destination-based forwarding based on the IPv6 address. Then we have the actual routing header. We see that the segments left field is set to 2. We have 3 segments in total. We read it from bottom to the top, and we start to count at 0. So the first segment is actually the segment 0, which is 6 in our case, which is the final destination. So this is how R1 pushes the frame on the wire, and this is also how R2 sees this packet. And from the perspective of R2, it just does default IPv6 forwarding. It doesn't care about the SRv6 header because it has no clue what this is about. So it just forwards the frame towards R3, so it makes a lookup based on the destination address. So we see already there seems to be some kind of relation between a SID and a prefix that is in the standard IP routing table for IPv6, and we will cover this in more detail, what the mechanism is and why this is actually useful. But for now, you see that the packet is actually not being changed. If you tap it on the wire between R1, R2, and R2, R3, you will see that it's actually the same, just that the destination MAC address, the source MAC address should have changed. But everything from the perspective of IPv6, you obviously decrease the TTL, but the rest of the fields stay more or less or stay unchanged. Now the packet actually hits R3. R3 sees its own IP address as the destination or its own SID as the destination, and this tells R3 that it should process the segment routing header that comes after the IPv6 header. And what R3 is now doing is it's decreasing the segment's left field by 1, so it's now set to 1, and this is telling the follow-up node, in this case R5, which is the currently now active segment in the whole stack of segments. So as mentioned before, we are not actually popping these segments, we are keeping them, but we just move the pointer around what is the currently now active segment in the world. Now R3 more or less does, R5 does more or less the same thing. It recognizes, hey, I'm having received a packet that's pointed to my SID, so I'm actually decreasing the segment's left field by 1, setting it to 0 now in this case, and then forwards the frame on. And now R7 more or less does the same as R2, so even though that R7 is segment routing enabled, it doesn't see its own destination address in the IPv6 header, so it's just forwards the frame on the next pass to actually reach R6. And when the packet reaches R6, R6 is recognizing that the segment's left field is actually 0, and because its destination address is set to its own address, it knows that it now should process the rest of the packet. So if it is, for example, an E-line service, it probably has an outgoing interface where it just forwards the frame unchanged. If it is maybe a VPN service for IPv4 or IPv6, it will process the make a standard routing lookup on the actual payload and forward this to the next station. One thing to keep in mind, and one thing that is very important, is that IPv6 SID is different compared to an MPLS SID because it's actually consisting of two parts. The first part is a locator, and the second part is a function. The locator is that what is used in the MPLS world, like similar like a node SID. So this is attracting all of the traffic to a certain node. So the locator has to be unique in your network for a specific node. It's identifying a specific node. And the function itself is identifying, as the name implies, a function on this node. And a function could be, if you're up for service chaining stuff, it could do some policing, some quality of service treatment, or do something else. And the other thing, obviously, that the function can be is could be actually identifying a service already. So it could identify your E-line service that this packet is belonging to. And this means that you actually can use a single IPv6 SID to actually signal the path to the end device, so what we used for MPLS networks, the transport label, and you can use the function, like the service label, within just one IPv6 SID. Whether this is a good idea or not is actually quite debated in the working group, but it's quite of normal that there are different opinions about this. Now, one thing to keep in mind is that this, what you see in here, the locator plus the function, is not really an IPv6 prefix. And this is also mentioned in the draft. I just copied these parts of the draft in here to my presentation because they're actually very important. And also very important to know how these non-SIV6 capable devices work in there. Because actually what the node does is, for algorithm zero, so don't worry about flex algo for the moment, just algorithm zero, is that the device that is owning this locator should advertise IPv6 prefix reachability TLD in ISIS, which basically means that all the other nodes will install a routing entry which is pointing to this node that owns this locator. So as you can see in here, in our case, we have 96 bits for the locator and 32 bits for the actual function. That would mean that all the other nodes will at the end have a /96 routing entry for this specific prefix. And this is the way how, in the example before, R2 can still forward the packet, because it sees the complete SID with the locator and the function as IPv6 destination address. It has no clue about SIV6, but it can do a routing lookup and gets a /96 routing entry and knows how to forward the packet on. So this is how, in the example before, R2, the non-segment routing enabled router, could actually still forward the packet. And this is also how the segment routing enabled router that was not having any active part in the segment routing could also forward this packet. Now, this should be done with algorithm zero. It should not be done with any other algorithm. So whenever your algorithm is different to zero, you would actually not install this prefix. And this is really to prevent, if you have a node in the network that does a forwarding decision based on an IPv6 SID, which is part of a different algorithm that this device is maybe not even part of, and that it would just forward the packet somewhere, so it would not really be predictable. Therefore, it should always only do this really for the algorithm zero, for the default SPF algorithm. Now, obviously, there are some challenges and something you need to watch when you actually deploy this in the network and want to make heavy use of defining an explicit path in your network. Because you are actually adding a lot of bits to the packet, because it is 128 bits of information. And if you do that multiple times, I made some calculations. I just use a packet size original of 576 bytes. But you can see in here the calculation, so feel free to redo this kind of calculation for whatever you see as the right average packet size for your network. However, you can see that by pushing this additional IPv6 header and segment routing header, we are adding a lot of overhead in there. So if you want to push 8 SIDs because you want to control the path in your network, you're actually adding 29% to the original payload and have a total of 23% bandwidth overhead on your circuit. So you just have to keep in mind, if you have a fully loaded 100 gig Ethernet interface, this would mean that you have 23 gigabits per second, which is not transmitting payload, but just signaling information for your network. So this is something to keep in mind if this is a problem. So we know bandwidth gets cheaper and cheaper, but at the end, you just need to consider this, because the other fact is that your transit devices now need to process the whole header of itself. And this is really a problem, because usually how networking ASICs works is they receive a packet, they store this in a buffer, and then they slice off a certain amount of bytes from the packet, the first bytes, and send this to the lookup engine, which does actually the lifting. And this one is then doing the processing, deciding where the packet goes to, reconstructing the header, putting it back to the buffer, and then it gets out. And obviously, if you have a lot of overhead and you have a lot more packets to be transmitted to the ASICs, and usually this is a finite amount of bytes that you have available for networking ASICs. So check this with your vendor if you want to make heavy use of this. On the one hand, you have to be sure that the ingress node can push all of this information in one go, and on the other hand, all your transit nodes need to be able to process the whole packet in order to see what is the currently active segment in there. As you can see in here with MPLS, naturally this is a lot lower because we just have 32 bits per label that we use. So you have much more, it's much more effective, but as I mentioned, it has other downsides because you need to have MPLS in your network, which might be a problem or might not, depends on your view on this. So there are also some initiatives in the working group to get these, to compress this a bit lower, make this a bit more effective. So obviously, if the SID is too large, you just make another standard where the SID is smaller. So there are two standards around there, which is or drafts around, which is CRH16, CRH32, which means compressed routing header. And you see in here that we got rid about all the optional TLV stuff and also some fields on this field. So we just have 32 bits of segment of SIDs in here. I didn't include the example for CRH16, but it's more or less the same, but the SIDs are 16 bits instead of 32 bits. And obviously, whenever we have a problem in the networking, we can still always encapsulate this in UDP and send this around if no other option is available. So also, therefore, there's a draft available that can use IPv4 or IPv6 as transport and forward the frames based on this. So I made some sample calculations in there, so you can see all of the technologies have their certain amount of overhead that they add to the packets. You see in here that the newer ones like CRH 16 and 32 and SR over UDP are in between the SRv6 and the MPLS data plane encapsulation. But they are still providing a bit more overhead than you used to. So now obviously the question is which of these standards will win at the end. And well, unfortunately, I cannot tell you this really. I can just give you my thinking about what I think is going to win. So currently, my personal guess would be that it is SRv6 because the working group seems to be quite have a lot of consensus that this is closely to an RFC. There's already code from vendors available that works. The versions with SR that use CRH16 and 32, they're kind of late in the game now, and there are also disputes about whether this is really a good idea because it's very similar to what we have done with MPLS, so we have to do something new maybe. So this is really something that needs to go out. It seems that the working group now wants to finish the working on SRv6 before defining anything else. So at the end, I cannot really tell you what it is, just my very personal guess about this. But I just tell you, you should be careful with my personal guess because I said similar things about HD, DVD in the past. And we all know how this ended up. So therefore, you should watch it yourself, which kind of technology wins, and be watching the overhead that you actually introduce with this. So this comes to the end of my presentation. So thanks a lot for your attendance in here. I think it's not sure if there's time for questions, but otherwise you'll find me at Centauro booth and we can happy to discuss about these topics further. Thanks a lot.